Well, I first heard about this from Ben Adams and Chris Wilkins when they invited me to Ben's studio to record a song as Evil Lord Hector. I had a great day with the two guys and heard all about the show and what they'd written and why they'd written it, and was so kind of taken with their quest for perfection. I mean, when I was recording, I'd be like, no, go again, we want it like this. And also just their attention to detail and their enthusiasm that I said, this is something really special and these lads are something really special. And last year we put on a concert performance at the London Palladium, sold that out. And it was a lot of fun. We just wanted to prove the concept, to see if an audience actually appreciated this as much as we did. And now we're here at the Other Palace for a full London run until the 3rd of March. And it's really, really exciting. The show has undergone an evolution. Script changes, songs have been rewritten. We've lost some songs, we've gained some new ones. But all of the material is brilliant. And it's really sad to see stuff go by the wayside. But what we have now is the condensed goodness, and people are loving it. Firstly, Eugenius is set in the 1980s, a decade that is really relevant to me. I was a teenager throughout that decade. I made Return of the Jedi in that decade, Willow, Labyrinth. And Eugenius really taps into that popular culture, the music, the celebrity, the gadgets and gizmos that we had back then, the clothing. But also the sound of the 80s. Now, we're not a jukebox musical. Ben has written 18 original songs for the show, but they have the palette of instruments that you would have heard back then. The keytar, the big drums and that sort of thing. So it's a lot of fun. It's really fun music. And what drew me to this was mainly that, but also the idea that we've got a kind of superhero story, but we also celebrate the underdog in the character of Eugene. He's a geek, self-confessed geek, And he draws comic books and dreams of success and one day wins a competition to go to Hollywood and make his comic, Tough Man, into a movie. And then we get to explore Hollywood in the 80s and all the manipulation that went on and the kind of craziness of that town. And by the end, we're really discovering that there is a hero in everyone, you know, and if you believe in something enough, you too can be a hero. So all of those themes just resonate with me, and it's very uplifting. I mean, I think theatre has to be an escape. You know, you want to come home from work, come and see a show, and then just pure escapism and come out uplifted, feeling good about the world. And that's what Eugenius can do. It's such a rich decade, you know. And also, it seems somehow it's unspoiled. You know, technology was there, but, you know, we didn't have mobile phones and stuff. There was a sort of a simpleness to that decade that now has kind of gone away and went away in the 90s and etc. And it seems like it was a lot of fun. I remember it being a lot of fun. You know, fashion, nobody cared if they wore pink leg warmers and had huge hair. It was, you know, you couldn't be too flamboyant in the 80s. And it's quite liberating, and I think that's why we keep going back to explore it. I mean, look at Stranger Things, how successful that show is. And you think, well, why is it? And it's because of the simplicity of the life and then all of these happenings within that, you know. I don't know. But, it, I mean, for me, I still love the music of the 80s, but my kids do as well, you know. Annabelle's 20 now and Harrison's 14. When I play them the first song from the concept album about 3.5 years ago, they loved it. They said, Dad, what is this? I said, well, it's a new musical that we're sort of working on. They said, oh, you've got to do this. It's brilliant. And they weren't alive in the 80s, but they kind of get it, you know. So I think it's just that sense of fun we get from that decade, which really, you know, attracts people to it. Live theatre is hugely important, you know. With video games and entertainment systems at home becoming more sophisticated and more immersive, you know, I think we do forget the thrill of live theatre. You know, you're sitting in an auditorium with the group experience, with the rest of the audience, and you're watching other performers up there, fellow human beings, entertaining you in a live environment where anything can happen. And that, you can't beat that, you know. So I'm a huge advocate for keeping live theatre going. And I think Eugenius is a great example of live theatre working at its very best. Because you're part of the show. It's all encompassing. And that group experience is what makes the whole thing so euphoric and kind of liberating. It's fantastic. But yeah, and I think what's great, the other palace is Andrew Lloyd Webber's theatre, you know, and his goal is to kind of nurture and support new projects and new musicals, because it's really expensive to do a show in London, and this theatre is a really great kind of proving ground and testing bed for new productions like this, and all original productions. So we're very excited. You know, figures in America last year, I think 17 new musicals opened on Broadway, but only two in this country. You know, so it's great to see original material. I mean, Jamie is a good example. That musical, it's original, it's British, and it's doing really well. So I would love that Eugenius could kind of follow in those footsteps.
Hi, I'm Aaron Free. I'm the choreographer for Eugenius. It's just a fun show. There's so much to talk about and where to start. But, you know, it's fun. It's the 80s. Who doesn't love the 80s? You know, you just get transported back in time. And it's full of laughs, excitement. Yeah, it's just a good fun show. Yeah, obviously with like the choreography for the show, there was a lot of 80s influences, like Flashdance, Maniac, all kind of like the 80s jazz, Janet Jackson kind of vibes, which is great for me. Like, I literally, they're my idols, like Janet and Michael. And obviously the music on the soundtrack just inspired me so much. Like, as soon as I heard them, I was ready to get up and go. I first got involved with the project about a couple of years ago. Had a meeting with one of the producers who I've worked with before, and I got played a few tracks and I was like, oh my god, this is amazing. Like, obviously I'm trained in musical theatre, but it's not something I've kind of been working with a lot. Do more of the commercial kind of side of things, so that when I heard these music, I was like, oh wow, this is kind of me. I really kind of connected with it, and they kind of suited me with the job, and then we kind of went from there. But yeah, it was just massively inspired by the music. This is why I want to get involved. That got me hooked straight away. Warwick's been amazing with his input in the show. You know, like, he was involved in the Palladium. That's when we started working together, because he actually played Evil Lord Hector back at the Palladium. So, ever since then, you know, it's been great to work with him creatively. He's played a massive part, just, you know, kind of getting the word out there, doing all the promo, and really just, like, because it's a brand new musical, it's so hard nowadays to try and get everyone to jump on board and stuff, and he's done an amazing job at getting everyone involved. I guess, like, with the Palladium, it was kind of just workshopping a few things. Obviously, it was a bigger stage, and at the other palaces, a lot smaller. But at the same time, I feel like having that slightly smaller, you feel like you're part of the show. You know, some of the front seats are literally, you can touch them. So, it was kind of confined, but it's an awesome stage design. It's really cool and unique. And, you know, I love a challenge and making things work, and just creatively having something new to do. So it's just not like kind of a plain blank stage, really. This is really interesting. So I've had a lot of fun with this. Obviously, back in the day, I was in S Club Juniors, so I've kind of gone from the pop star to the choreographer, taking a back seat. But no, behind the scenes, it's fun. I love being a creative. I trained in musical theatre. I became a dancer after the band as well, so I've kind of got a lot of experience, like, kind of being the singer, behind the singer, and now it's the time to kind of coach them, I guess. I started with doing choreography for The X Factor. And then that's kind of evolved, and now I kind of do for different artists and things. And then obviously a musical theatre background, I kind of just married the two together, and here we are with my first musical, which is also exciting. Like, this is the first time I've actually got to work with actors and really start getting creative with my work. And obviously, because it's a fun show, it's a comedy, it's been fun to put the comedy into the choreography also. Just the West End, like, in itself, like, you know, I think even just walking down the street at night, you know, you've got lights flashing, you've got all the adverts for the musicals, and, you know, there's such a buzz around kind of 7 o'clock, half seven, and then obviously when the shows come out, you know, you feel like, oh, I want to go see that, I want to be a part, and there's like kind of a rush in the air that, you know, London's got that special vibe, and especially it's got such a love for the theatre, and, you know, I'm so happy that we get to bring Eugenius into this kind of world. But yeah, I hope everyone enjoys it tonight.
So it's set in the 80s. It's about a kid named Eugene who is a very skilled comic book artist. And every night he goes to bed and has dreams of distant worlds and galaxies, wakes up and draws them. His friends think he's a very talented artist. And just by chance, a Hollywood movie company are looking for a vehicle for their German action star. He wins a competition, goes to Hollywood to get his comic book ideas turned into a movie, and I'll leave it there because it goes a little bit...
No, let's not leave it there. You've got to explain. Okay. So basically, all of his dreams turn out to be reality, and all of his comic book visions come to the set of Hollywood and cause absolute carnage. So, you know, I think we can do, we can give that spoiler.
Yeah. Okay.
You know,
so
that's
fine. Sort of Rocky Horror with the kids from Stranger Things and the Goonies crossing over with each other with an amazing 80s original score.
Well, it wasn't that difficult to capture it because it was such a fantastic era of music, the 80s. And, you know, with all the pop culture and all the movies, and we grew up then. So basically, when we first started out writing this musical, we just wanted to put everything that we love about musical theatre, everything we love about growing up, all of our favourite movie references, all of our favourite, you know, soundtracks of the 80s, and put it all into one show and do something. It's like a new nostalgia.
Yeah.
Nostalgic trip.
And I think if you think of all the films at the time that people seemed to love, the Goonies and E.T. and all of those things, they were quite crazy ideas, but they had like an emotional attachment, an emotional resonance, as I like to think of it as, that I think that's what people keep coming back to, and I think that's hopefully what we've captured in our show as well. It's very silly, but there's a heart to it at the same time.
You've got to come and see the show.
Yeah.
And then you will know. It's basically like us emptying our brains onto the stage of everything that we love, you know, and we were the biggest geeks going in you know, growing up in the 80s, and you know, that's what it's all about. So, you know, I don't want to spoil it for them. I want people to come and see it and just experience the joy for themselves.
But I'll give you a hint though, if we've got Mark Hamill as a voiceover, there may be a few Star Wars references in there. Well, when we started writing the project, there was a part that we always said from day one we wanted Warwick to read for and to be. And we didn't really think we'd get a chance to work with him on it. But through one of our connections, Warwick agreed to come in and actually record a song. And that was over 3 years ago. And kind of that relationship working with him has blossomed. And he's been a magnificent supporter for us. And we've just adored working with him.
Yeah, it's been fantastic. I mean, when do you get to work with your absolute heroes growing up? It's like a dream. We keep sitting there just pinching ourselves, going like, oh my God, is this happening? And to see the reaction from the audiences coming out with just grinning from ear to ear, you know, all throughout the show, it's just a dream come true.
Obviously, you mentioned there Mr. Mark Hamill himself recording audio for the show. Can you talk a little bit about how that came about and how much fun you guys had working with Luke Skywalker?
Yeah, I mean, we recorded with him over the phone. He was in LA. I think he was in LA at the time. Yeah. So he was saying, well, how would you like it done? You know, and he'd do a couple of takes and we'd go, could you maybe do it a bit more like this and stuff? He's such an amazing voice actor. You know, it's Luke Skywalker, for goodness sake. I mean, you don't get a bigger seal of approval on a show like this, a sci-fi based show, than from Luke Skywalker himself, Mark Hamill. So, I mean, we were like two little kids. You can see there's a clip on social media of us putting it up, and we were like literally like trying to play it really cool and be like, no, Mark, well, do a bit more like this, you know, this kind of stuff. And we were just like, oh my God, it's incredible.
It was pretty special. We knew we were going to record it, but we didn't know when. And obviously with the time differences, we finished our very first preview. So it was quite an emotional sort of evening for us anyway. And then Warwick handed a phone and said, can you call this number in LA? Mark wants to speak to you. And I nearly fell over. I was so excited. But I've got to say, they say about meeting your heroes or talking to your heroes, he was the nicest man, had so much time for us, and also does a fantastic, fantastic performance in this. We got another five weeks ago. Tickets are going very fast. Their word of mouth is really helping.
We've actually just had to add a few more dates to the run because of popular demand, which is amazing. So, you know, as Chris said, people just need to grab their tickets now. You can get it at eugeniusthemusical.com.
Or the Other Palace website as well, theotherpalace.com.
Yeah, and then follow us on Twitter, Eugenius UK, on Instagram, Eugenius The Musical.
Hashtag Go Eugenius.
Yes. Come and be a geek with us.
Sold.
Hiya, I'm Liam Ford. I'm playing Eugene. Eugene is a very talented comic book writer and artist, and he has big dreams of his comic going to Hollywood, and through the help of his friends, his comic book story ends up getting turned into a Hollywood movie. Things go awry, things aren't quite as he had planned, and he follows his destiny and becomes a superhero at the end. Well, the cast is the loveliest cast I've ever had the privilege of working with. We all get along so well, it may be apparent from the fun we're having on stage. We have such professionals working with us. And I think a lot of this play is about that too. The show is that Eugene couldn't do what he does without the help of Janie, without Ferris, even without learning a lesson from Lex. The 1980s were, everything had this larger-than-life quality, big hair, big bright colors, and I think that's something that Chris and Ben have captured so brilliantly in the music and in the script. All of the characters are larger-than-life. Every song has its own different kind of 80s sound to it. So I think they've done an absolutely brilliant job.
How special is it to have Mr. Mark Hamill himself voicing one of your characters?
It's a dream come true. Anybody that loves Star Wars and they hear this man's voice, it's just going to be, it's going to blow their minds. It's amazing. Well, I do love when Laura Baldwin sings The Future is Bright. It cracks me up every single time. Aaron Renfrey's choreography is so brilliant on that, and the tune is just so catchy, like all of the songs in Eugenius. I love, she's amazing. It changes by the hour sometimes. I don't think there's a song in the show that I don't like. London, I think because I'm American, obviously. I think that British people have such a command of language, and often they will say you don't go to see a play, you go to hear a play. So I think, the West End aside, London is, I mean, some would argue is the theater capital of the world.
Hi, I'm Daniel Buckley, and I play Ferris in Eugenius. Okay, so you have the three, as they're described, the three heroes. So you've got Eugene, Janie, and Ferris. Eugene is the principal character who comes up with the comic book idea, and his two best friends are Janie and Ferris. And Ferris is he's the chunk of the situation. You know, he's the goofball that has no filter, that is that has every single reference under his belt, every impression under his belt of every cult 80s movie and comic book of the time. So he wears like golf trousers. He's got some really nice original Reeboks, which are beautiful. A nice floral shirt, a woolen tank top that goes over the top, and a classic red Mac. He looks a lot like Chunk. I think they got a lot of inspiration for that. Messy hair, the dream. And it's the hardest thing I've ever had to do. Obviously, the rap is the first number I do, so I come in sort of all guns a-blazing, and I had the rap, so I have to make sure that obviously I'm warm enough, I'm articulate enough to be able to punch all those lines out. And then, of course, you have later on, you've got the seductive song, which is No Pants Dance, which has got a lot of falsetto in it, so it's kind of, it does everything in my track. And then I've got some nice, a big bit in there, Don't Shoot for the Stars as well. It's the hardest track I've ever had to do, and obviously on top of being on the front foot with the dialogue and that placement and everything, it's hard, it's hard graft. I've been looking after myself as much as I can, lots of rest, lots of vocal rest, steaming. It's the hardest work I've had to do, so it's the most I've had to take care of myself.
How special is it not only to be part of this wonderful homage to the 1980s, but to have Warwick Davis behind the show and the voice of Mr. Mark Hamill in the show?
Yeah, we heard a little titter that might be happening, and we're all like, nah. I mean, we're so grateful that he came on board, and I think, I don't think it's necessarily just about the fact that Warwick knows him, and it's like a mate's job. I think he understood the piece, and they had to explain the piece to him for him to get behind it, because I don't think he would just throw his voice at anything. And Warwick is so amazing. He's always so generous and so warm and just so kind. He's lovely to work with. He's so lovely to work with. Do I have a favourite 80s reference? I think sort of Omen Give Me Sight Beyond Sight, because of how it works within the scene. I think it just drives that moment forward, and I think for Ferris it's all about, it's just a classic moment where he's managed to take something that's in his vocabulary and put it into the real world. Yeah. It's all about the underdog and having conviction in yourself and being able to overcome the odds, and knowing that by sticking to your guns and being passionate enough, you will overcome anything and you will ultimately succeed.